Now pay attention, Mr. Beardsley said to the class. I'm only going to say this once. There were three main solutions considered to be the most practical and effective by the generation more commonly known as your parents. These planned solutions were hatched in underground laboratories by cyborg scientists of the government, and they proposed three scenarios for the world's future. The first was known as the Hitler Enema, the second as Mussolini Facelift, and finally, there was the Roach Addendum. Let us start with a look at the Hitler Enema. In the early 2000s, a political speaker calling himself the Adoring Roberts emerged. Many of you, I'm sure, have heard this name. Perhaps it was whispered or cursed repeatedly nearby your cradle when you were just a whelp growing up. Perhaps the older generation in your family still curses to this very day the name of the Adoring Roberts. You see, this guy founded a loose political party, first known as Flounder Nation, and then changed to the Hitler Enema. The Adoring Roberts took all sorts of funding from any number of places. He let each corporate contributor have a say in the directions, views, and moral values of the party. This was done to such a degree as to render the party virtually addictive, with all the flavor that McDonald's, Walmart, and Coke could provide. Deep into the belly of its third year, the Hitler Enema party members mostly consisted of brainwashed consumers, drooling for greasy hamburgers. And there were tens of millions of them, from sea to oily sea, like shrimp between some batter. They had all begun to wait for some clearer definition of their party's goals and strategies. But their inevitable partaking of the free and complimentary food at participating franchises given to all Hitler Enema party members by prearranged corporate contract led them to spare tires, hangovers, wife beatings, divorce, palimony, several suicide attempts, and if none are successful, then total spirit, love, and allegiance go to the Hitler Enema. They began to live for burgers, fries, soda, and desserts. Their clothes sizes went into the 5Xs. On women it was especially hard. Their boobs would flop under their arms as they slept, and the next day their breasts would smell like armpits. And on both men and women, the belly would slowly enlarge and sag, covering the sexual organs like an obscene eclipse. Local hicks were known to yell, "That thar monkey twig done gun too fat to fuck!" whenever they saw such extreme party members make their rare ventures into the open public in daylight. The total inaction of Hitler Enema party leaders only served to soften the rest of the country, and in time, 98% of the nation were claiming their free fast food products and flashing their membership cards at new franchise partners like liquor stores and Indian casinos. You have no conception of how hard and frustrating it was to be your parents and grandparents. Their lives were chock full of hardships and despair, because research has found that the fast food products of their time were acting as clinical depressants. Lawsuits that had been ongoing for years were eventually won, and that is how your fat, lazy parents got the money to support you. You were here today because of the Hitler Enema, which, incidentally, petered out with the stock market. Any questions? Is suicide the best solution? Someone in the back row asked. Mr. Beardsley pushed the rim of his glasses an inch up the bridge of his nose, focused sharply, and said to the student, "It was good enough for your parents to repeatedly attempt, and by God, it's good enough for you too." "What about the Mussolini facelift campaign?" a bright girl in front inquired, her eyes fixed fondly on Mr. Beardsley's crotch. "I heard that kind of counteracted things." "Unfortunately, it did," said Mr. Beardsley. "Queers became proud of their queerness, and fat people sat on public toilets eating hoagies and laughing. Everyone wanted to live, became obsessed with decadent living, craving to hold their nose higher than their neighbors. Vomiting contests became all the rage. Serious prize money was at stake for the man or woman who could vomit the most. In official contests, they vomited directly into a basin placed on a scale. They were allowed 90 seconds to vomit the most that they could. Wagering soon became common at these events, as did prostitution. Wickedness soared to such a height that it was finally time to implement the Roach Addendum." Beardsley took a piece of chalk and drew a picture of a scythe on the blackboard. Next to it, he drew a smiley face. "When people get too sloppy and they love violence so much that they're hurting themselves, it's time for the Roach Addendum. And we are nearing that time, class. We will have our heads chopped off by the government's underground cyborg warriors. We will meet our maker with black stains on our souls, sin in our minds, and cum in our mouths. The Roach Addendum will harvest sinners at the peak of their evilness, like Juan Valdez. He is the worst sinner of all, the things he did to that mule. But I digress. The point is, this is an important triad theory, not unlike the more famous Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Believing in it is totally voluntary, unless it has brainwashed you, in which case the response is more or less involuntary. At the very least, it suggests a way to avoid the hedonistic lesbianism that has so prevailed as of late in the weary heterosexual world. After all, you don't care if that piece of fish you're eating was gay, or if that hamburger came from a queer steer. All you want to do is process them. You don't even need to savor them or even enjoy them. You are interested in subsistence. You wish to live long through mass infection. You, yourselves, are little units of the Roach Addendum. And I'm truly sorry, class, for what is about to happen." Metal sheaths raised from the floors and blocked the exits. At the push of a button, Mr. Beardsley's podium was encased in a protective bubble of plexiglass. From the ceiling vents, a hissing came as poison was released. Beardsley watched the panicked student struggle. He learned close to the microphone. He leaned close to the microphone. Still there in their midst, desperate fists pounding on his bubble, the public address speakers still carrying his voice as he said, "Sweet little units, sleep well." He looked at his watch. Another class would start soon. He'd have to do it all over again in an hour. how tedious it was to wait there in his bubble for the students to die. To wait for the fresh air to be returned to the lecture hall, and to wade through the sprawled bodies to make it to his car to grab a quick bit of lunch. Thank you.